Party end.
Members, it is about time and we have formed a quorum and now call the meeting to order. Today's meeting will end at 5:30, extendable by 15 minutes. Just a reminder that should members have any direct or indirect pecuniary interest, please, under ROP 83A, make the disclosure on the nature of the interest. And also, under 84 of ROP, it provides for the voting arrangement if there is some pecuniary interest. Paper FCR 2020-2183, this item seeks members' endorsement of the PWSC recommendations in PWSC 2020-2123 made in its meeting on December 16th, A, to approve a total allocation of $24.283 billion for 2021-22 for the block allocation under the CWRF and to increase the approved allocation for subhead 9100WX under head 709 for 2020-21 by $294 million from $1.6 million to $1.9 million. B. Increase the financial ceiling of delegated authority from $30 million to $50 million per item for 21 works-related block allocation subheads under CWRF heads of expenditure 702 to 707, 708 part capital subventions 709 and 711. And increase the financial ceiling from $10 million to $20 million. The PWSC spent 2 hours and 20 minutes on this item. I must make the declaration that I am the director and CEO of WellLink Insurance Holdings. I'm also the director of the WellLink Insurance Company and also director of WellLink Insurance. We have with us the secretary for Financial Services and Treasury, Mr. Christopher Hoy, and a whole host of other officials. I'd like to call upon Mr. Hoy to brief members on this item first. Members, we urge members to approve the block allocation for 2021-22 to the tune of $24.28 billion. $17 billion have to do with works. And we also have $1.3 billion for the computer item. There are 26 items covering a broad range of subjects, like landslip prevention, refurbishment of current buildings, drainage, waterworks, and also the advanced work for some of the infrastructure work. We have a whole team of colleagues to address members' questions. The 2021-22 block allocations, a total 16,000 items, 13,000 items have already got underway in the previous year. The block allocation arrangement is intended to enable the government to exercise flexibility and to get on with the minor standalone improvement works that are important to the community, and members will be able to use the time more effectively to address the important items. In the light of inflation, there were 6 occasions on which the government sought legislative approval to adjust the financial ceiling. The latest one, the last one, was in 2015. It was about 8 years ago. In order to maintain the usefulness of the delegated authority, we proposed it for 21 items to do with works. The delegated authority will be increased from $30 million to $50 million. For the subhead 9100WX, it should be increased from $10 billion, or subhead A007GX should go up from $10 million to $20 million. On 16th of October last year, we consulted the panel's views, and members generally were in support of the proposal. And I hope that the Finance Committee would do likewise and support this proposal and adjust the financial ceiling of the delegated authority so that the government can go ahead with the minor works that have everything to do with livelihood. While we use the funding flexibly, we will make sure that the funding mechanism will be transparent. And in submitting the projects, we will also submit a checklist of all the items that will be using this allocation. We will bring members up to date on a quarterly basis and bring members up to date on the latest regarding the utilization of the fund. By the end of the financial year, we also have the annual report to let members know the main items, main breakdowns of the block allocation. We have 20 also representatives from across different bureaus and departments to address members' questions, and I hope the members will give us their support. Mr. Michael Look, 5 minutes, please. Chairman, I am concerned about the increase to $50 million regarding the financial ceiling of the delegated authority. As we said at the PWSC, the government should play a better role in cost control. They should not give people the impression that they are condoning the contractors and allow them to inflate the costs. We would like to expedite the community district work. As I said a couple of days ago at the council meeting, I would be as strict as one piece of paper. And the government should achieve saving as far as they can. And we have to make sure that the money is going to be well spent and improve the environment in the community. These Category D projects, most of them are environmental improvement, transport, and the minor standalone projects. And I'd like to say that the district councils seem to have some issue that the people feel that the council cannot represent their views. And they also feel that certain members may have valid points regarding a certain neighborhood, but for some political reason in the district councils, things are pretty political. And the mutual destructive members may not subscribe to certain views. Now, my question for the administration is this. Now, for the district minor works, if you feel that there are merits for them, are you going to be steadfast in your proposal? And also, will you heed the advice of the consultative bodies in the community so that we are more in tune with the public sentiments and public views? Secretary, thanks very much, Mr. Look. I heard two questions there. The first one is that we have increased the ceiling from $30 million to $50 million with a larger sum the baby problems. Now, indeed, this is a valid question. We have to make sure that we will get our money's worth. We are just as concerned as you are with the delegated authority. The controlling officer in exercising the authority will be very stringent in controlling the cost. We have the PSGO under the Development Bureau, which is looking at the Cat A projects. And it doesn't include Category D projects. These are of a minor nature and cost a little less. But like Mr. Look said, we have to make sure that cost control is important. The PSGOA is examining the situation with the increase in the financial ceiling and the projects between $30 million to, and $50 million. CAT D projects, they will conduct examination and monitoring on these projects. Now, Mr. Look has a point there that when we take forward these projects, we should take into account of the views of the members of the public. We also interact with various organizations in the community to make sure that what we do will be in line and in response to the public views. Like you said, when we start the projects, we have to look at the priority, the procedures, and we decide on the priority likewise. The controlling officers, when taking forward the projects, will have to have regard to see whether they are included in the scope and whether they are within the delegated authority and roll out projects that are in line with the public needs. So this is something that we've been doing. The district council and other bodies will certainly be listened to, and the HAD colleagues might wish to supplement. Yes, district consultation, how can you take into account a broad range of views? Yes, please. Thanks, Chairman. For district minor works, the purpose is to improve the environmental hygiene and the living condition and to raise the quality of life in general. So we will be bouncing off ideas in the community. At the district council, we would gather public views. Now, the member asked whether we can heed the views of other stakeholders. We keep our options open here. We would proactively consider how we can absorb different views. Maybe we can consult more district organizations and residents' bodies to make sure that projects will be in line with public needs. Mr. Chen Chenying, Chairman. For CAT D, the delegated authority, the ceiling is increased from $30 million to $50 million. The Secretary said the last revision was in 2012. The cost of living and the project costs have also gone up over the years. At the ITBP and Development Panel joint meeting, that was supported. And in December 2020, the FSTB wrote to the joint panel meeting in Annex 2. It shows the basis for the cost revision. 2020 to 30, there are projected figures. 2020, it was 3%. 2021 to 25, 5%. As we can see from the inflation, yesterday, the figure was hovering around zero. Now, if you adopt 5% over the coming 5 years, it would be a bit unrealistic or overly optimistic. I understand that $30 million to $50 million, we may not be able to reach that. Maybe you need some room and round up the figure to $50 million. You have my support there, but I don't think we should make such a really exaggerated projection. I think that the government should present another paper regarding the cost revision figures. And it would be hard for us to accept this particular projection. Second, for CAT D projects, from time to time, in the CAT A project, we tend to have the contingency normally of 10%. Now, the nature of the 10% has to do with the cost revision. If we have, we give the delegated authority that they can address the cost revision, maybe if there is a contingency, we can revise the contingency downward so that we're not going to be reserving the resources twice. Now, because you're tying up the resources and cannot release them until the end of the project.
Who's going to take this question, please? I want to thank Mr. Chen for his comments. I want to get back to him on 2 points. First, about the supplementary information about the price adjustment factor, but that's not an issue at all. We can provide the information. You can see it's 3%, 5% at the point. You see the figures on the high side, but there is a like possibility that now that the denominator is smaller, so you see a higher increase. That may be one of the reasons. And the second point, we are adjusting the figure upward because we want to focus on the days to come. This figure will remain valid for a long time to come, so we have to make allowances for things that may happen, that may change in the days to come. But I want to thank Mr. Chen for his support for our proposal. And the second point, about contingency fees. Now that has nothing to do with the price adjustment factor. Chair, is he saying that for Category D works projects, there will be no contingency fees under those projects? Can I confirm with the Secretary on this point? Deputy Secretary, well, we're not saying that there's no contingency forming part of any Category D project. What we're trying to say here is that contingency fees are not meant to provide any on the price adjustment mechanism. These two things are separate things. Now, of course, contingency fees may not be something that's meant to cover price adjustment, but I'm saying if we already are making allowances in terms of the financial ceilings for delegated authority, do we still need to make allowances, have some kind of buffer for potential increases in project costs? After all, we are already factoring in any potential increase in costs in the future. I want to invite my colleagues from the Development Bureau to elaborate on this point. Mr. Hong.
Thank you, Chair. As my colleague from the FSTB was saying, for minor works, if it's Category A works, we do set aside some money for contingency fees. But for minor works, the works get done relatively quickly. For preparing the estimate, we do not necessarily set aside money for contingency fees. But for works projects, there are unforeseen circumstances, drainage projects, for example, or excavation projects. For those kinds of projects, we may have to set aside money for contingency fees. But as for the future, will there be allowances made for these projects? It comes down to the kind of project. Some projects may be subject to greater uncertainties. For works where we can kind of make allowances for the inflation, then we will not set aside extra buffer for those projects. Thank you. Mr. Tony Tseh, 5 minutes. With the ongoing epidemic and now the economic recession, the unemployment in the construction sector stands at 10.7%, much higher than the overall unemployment rate at 6.6%. Now, in the policy address, the chief executive pledged more spending on infrastructure that is at least $100 billion for the construction sector. But I hope we do not leave out small and medium enterprises. So for the $24+ billion, the money will cover mostly minor works. I support your proposal, but I also want to draw your attention to this point. Don't bundle things up together. Minor works mean a lot to SMEs. on this matter, I want to talk about paragraph 10 in the paper, the additional funding for $290 million. You're saying there will be 35 new items for the risk-based improvement works to water means and 19 ongoing projects, the additional cash flow requirements. Can you tell us why all of a sudden we have the 35 new items for risk-based improvement works for water means and for the 19 ongoing projects? You're saying that the progress is better than expected, so you're paying early. Given the epidemic, we see delays in works projects. But in this case, you're saying you're ahead of schedule and you have to pay, but for sure I support that. And then in paragraph 6 in the paper about the refurbishment of public toilets, had 703. 2 years ago, the government said there would be $600 million for 240 public toilets across the territory. I want to know what the progress is like. Is that covered? How much of the money has been spent on the refurbishment work? And also want to thank the Food and Environmental Hygiene Department and the Architectural Services Department for the initiative about public toilets. I want to thank them for taking on board some of our views on unleashing the creativity of young people and our views. And I know there has been competitions in that regard. Now, if a sector and the young people put forward valid suggestions, if you have, and then you have other enhancement projects for public toilets, would they be adopted? Another point about the head 705, subhead 5101DX. There's this part about in Wenchai, Shamshui Po, the green initiatives. But the price tag is relatively modest. I want to know, are the works complete and you're just paying the final sum? If you're getting $2+ billion per year, then that should be able to cover many years. So my question is, what's the progress of a GCS initiative? How much of the work has already been completed? Who's going to take this question, please? He brought up this point about community, about unleashing creativity in the community. I want to invite the Water Supplies Department, CEDD, to talk about this. Let's get the representatives from the WSD. Thank you, Chair. About the 35 risk-based waterworks improvement works. Can you hear me? Please go on. For the WSD, we review the status of the water mains network from time to time. If we identify mains that require improvement works, then we will include those projects under our scope as new works projects. Last year, we have seen black spots where water mains would burst more often. We put those places under our works. In September 2019, we didn't foresee these situations, so we're including them as new items. And for the 19 ongoing projects, we are getting ahead of schedule for the 19 ongoing projects. Yeah. And that has to do with a number of factors in terms of manpower, for example. Our contractors have been able to get ample manpower to work on those projects. And in 2020, in terms of the weather, we had fewer days of inclement weather. For those reasons, we were able to be ahead of our schedule on those works. I think that would mean benefits for the market, the labor market. Next, I want to talk about the refurbishment of the public toilets. The total estimate was that in 5 years, we will finish the refurbishment works for 240 public toilets. And in 2019 and 20, we kickstarted 42 such works projects. 18 of them have been completed. And in 2020 and 2021, we plan to kickstart 49 such projects. Some enhancement works, 5 of them have been completed. And in 2021 to 22, we plan to get 50 such enhancement works done. And from 2022 onwards, for 2 years, there will be 550 enhancement works in each year. We're working hard on that front. Much is underway. And I hope citizens can also take notice that the enhancement works are being completed at different times. And as for the minor works, can we get competitions for young architects to take part in? Members may take note that we're working with the FEHD. It's an initiative about public toilets. The idea is that about learning from staff working at public toilets, help us understand what's needed at public toilets. There are workshops. And there is a design competition. We're preparing phase one of the competition. 4 teams have been shortlisted. Now they will develop a deeper understanding of how public toilets work, and then we will pick a winner. And then we will go ahead to have those kinds of competitions. And about the GCS project, let me just briefly talk about the GCS, because after all, the ASD is also the works agent of the GCS initiatives. In Wan Chai, the building there, as you can see, is at the final stage. And we're just waiting for the wiring of the power cords to be completed. And then it will be handed over to the Environmental Bureau. The phase one of the GCS works are at the final stage. We have run into some difficulties in securing the suitable sites in certain districts. Sometimes it has to do with the site and or underground conditions. I know that the relevant government departments are working hard, and they're trying to identify the appropriate sites. That's all from me. Next, Mr. Michael Tin, 5 minutes. Thank you, Chair. I want to say something about item B. It's about the financial ceiling of Category D projects. Now, you want to raise this from $30 million to $50 million per item. Last time, the adjustment happened in 2012 from $21 to $30 million. I put that question to you. There is no way that the inflation over the 8 years was such that you need to raise the ceiling from $30 to $50 million. And then you told me we shouldn't be looking at 8 years because some works projects are due to complete in 2024 onwards. So we're talking about inflation over 12 years. That's why I supported this proposal at the PWSC stage. I have no crystal ball over what will happen over the next 4 years. Maybe deflation will set in. Just then, another member, like, there's no way you expect the same kind of inflation in the several years to come. Now we see over the past, 18 years, the inflation was 37.5%. Crunch the math. I come to the figures $40 million. Now if you're just raising the ceiling to $40 million, that makes sense for 12 years of inflation. But that just doesn't add up. Now, back in the days when I was doing my MBA, you have to calculate the figures on a compound basis. After crunching the numbers, the figure comes down to 44.5%. $30 million times the factor just meant that would be $44 million-ish. But now you're saying you want to raise the ceiling to $50 million. Now you're saying you round up the figures. But then the idea is about rounding off is that you should get the figure down to $40 million instead of rounding up to $50 million. It just makes no sense to me. So I want to vote against this proposal because I think you're going too far in raising the financial ceiling. Now, you may be saying, hey, we're standing in the way of progress, but then look at the electrical these days. Things are running smoothly. Some people may argue things are going too smoothly for its own good. If you have a project that exceeds $44 million, you should come to us for our scrutiny because we need to get some work done. If you raise the ceiling to $50 million and these works projects, we don't have to come to the Finance Committee. Why increase the ceiling to $50 million?
Secretary, thanks very much. Mr. Tin, there are two parts to your question, actually. The first one is $30 million to $50 million, the logic, the rationale behind it. Like Mr. Tin said rightly, the inflation is one of the factors in designing the ceiling. We not only do we have to look at the past, we have to look into the future. There is a bit of a time gap. We present this today and we still have to catch up with the inflation level over the years. So we have to have a projection before we can come up with an appropriate ceiling. Second, here in Legco, members over the past year probably have noticed that these projects cover so many items. We have 20 or so colleagues here today. Is inflation the only factor? Not necessarily. Now for price adjustment, it is due to a whole basket of factors, the construction cost, the labor sector situation, and so on. So inflation is one of the factors at play. So that's why we would like to increase the amount, Chairman. Time-wise, I'd like to put a question here. I think it is problematic. Objectively, you should look at inflation when you revise the ceiling. I obviously will look at inflation. It's very arbitrary. You can say 60 million, 70 million. It's all very arbitrary. I find it wholly unacceptable. But you have your own argument. But I don't think I can convince myself. I can't bring myself to support this. Yes, please. Chairman, thank you. We explained last time together with the Development Bureau, we look at the inflation. It is a broad term. In fact, it covers a whole basket of factors, like the public sector building data, the labor sector, building materials, and the price movement in these different categories. We look at from 2012 to 2020, over this eight-year horizon, we look at the inflation. For minor works, it would take about 3 or 4 years to complete. So the payment would be divided up into 3 to 4 years. So this broad brush inflation factor doesn't stop at 2020. We would project forward. We cover a couple more years to cover 2023, 24, or the inflation figure would be included as well. Turn up the mic for Mr. Tin, please. Chairman, I've embedded this. If we stop at 2020, you will not be that high. For 2024, I would take the inflation rate between 16 and 20. Do you think that we're going to experience this, the same inflation as we did in the past few years? We're going to see deflation. They said there are other factors. So this is all very arbitrary, isn't it? You said the projects are more difficult. What about next time? You're going to say it will be $100 million. I supported you at the beginning, but after revising, reviewing the figures, I don't think I can convince myself. You may say that I walk back on my words, but I'm telling you that I cannot bring myself to support it after reviewing the figures. Mr. Leng Chi-Chung, at the PWSC, I raised something similar to Dr. Ching Chung Tai, that the government made a reply to say that many of the projects are at the preliminary stage of conception. I don't have the figures regarding the projects that are over $30 million. Now we're going to up the ceiling to $50 million. We don't have the data here. It is disappointing to us if the government feels, in particular the Works Department feels, that of the 80 items, many of them have had the prices artificially suppressed. Maybe they've gone beyond $30 million, but you artificially suppress the price to keep it within $30 million before they can go ahead. Now, if you have the figures like this, please show them to us so that you are justified in your proposal. You cannot produce the figures. Now, for some of the projects, a lot of them have to do with repair, maintenance, sports ground, the stadiums, the community halls. Now, you can control the prices there. The other thing is the drainage works. One of the officials said that it would be rather difficult for you to work out whether there would be overspending. I feel that we can allow the government some degree of flexibility for other matters like repair, renovation work, their routine, 5-yearly or 10-yearly cycle kind of repairs and maintenance. You must have the budget in mind. You can control the cost. Why do you have to put it up to $50 million? Mr. Tien and Mr. Chan mentioned inflation. Looking at inflation, they simply cannot come up with the ceiling. If you ask us to endorse $50 million, you have to show us the projects. I'm sure that you're going to be doing similar projects. How can you convince us that it is $50 million? Can't you do it with $40 million? Why $50 million to start with? Secretary, Chairman, thank you. Thanks very much, Mr. Leung. Mr. Leung and Mr. Tien raised the question, and I think basically they're talking about how LESCO can supervise. In answer to members' questions in writing, I said that we're not sure how many projects will be between $30 million and $50 million, but we can go back to history. 2019 to 20, there were two that were somewhere between $30 and $50 million. 2017-18, there were three. 2018-19, there was none. So between $30 million and $50 million, the number of projects were not that many. Mr. Tien and Mr. Leung raised similar concerns that with the increase in the ceiling, how are we going to effectively LESCO monitor us? We will not be undermining LESCO's ability to monitor us. With the delegated authority, we have to exercise the authority carefully. So we do have very clear guidelines to make sure that the controlling officer will be abiding by the guidelines. Now, some said that some may make the projects smaller to bring it within the ceiling. Now, the controlling officer has to work on the basis of the ceiling in creating these CAT-D projects. They cannot break down the larger projects into the smaller one just because they want to evade or circumvent LESCO. So we do have guidelines that would spell out these particular requirements so members can rest assured. At the very beginning, when I briefed members on this proposal, I also said that in the days to come, we're going to have the quarterly and annual reports for members' scrutiny. So I hope the members will understand why we are putting forward this proposal, and we will be opening ourselves up for scrutiny. Dr. Lo Wai Kwok, 5 minutes, please. Chairman, thank you. Couple of things. First of all, 2021-22, the CWRF. This $24 billion, the BPA is in support of that. Block allocation, $9.2 billion for land acquisition, $1.3 billion for the administrative computerization. The rest of them are the actual capital works. Now, these are minor standalone capital works. There are something like 16,000 projects. The cost is $24 billion covering these 16,000 projects. The minor projects, 21-22, the CWRF allocation has to be adjusted upwards by $294 million. I'm in support of this proposal also. For these minor projects, they come from various departments, and they have everything to do with livelihood. The minor works will be terribly important to the SMEs in Hong Kong as well. For the delegated authority, it will be increasing from $30 million to $50 million for the 21 work-related items. This is since 2012, and this is having regard to the increase in the construction costs. When LegCo scrutinizes these projects, we have to prioritize them. We will prioritize the larger projects that at higher cost. Now we're drawing the line at $30 million. There are 90 or so projects that will be coming to LegCo for funding. I think we have to bear in mind this. Not only do we have to look at the arithmetic, we have to bear in mind that the council's work has to have regard to the priority list. I'm sure that over the years, we had this is one of the reasons why we have this kind of ceiling. Members may see this differently regarding the financial ceiling. I won't object to their views, but as someone who has been chairing the PWSC and also as someone representing the engineering sector, we are looking at these from multiple angles. Computerisation, since 1996, we haven't seen any adjustment. Now it is going to going up from $10 million to $20 million, and I think this is an appropriate course of action. I very much hope that today these proposals, these block allocation will sail through today's meeting. Given the pandemic, if we want to revitalize the economy, the infrastructural projects would be playing a significant role. And this is not something unique to Hong Kong and other parts of the world facing this adversarial situation. Infrastructure-led development is a common strategy. For these projects, they have everything to do with livelihood, and they are important in improving the public's livelihood. I've got nothing to ask members, except to say that I support these projects. Dr. Ching Chung Tai, Chairman. Now, for these delegated authority, financial ceiling will increase from $30 million to $50 million. That's for Cat D project. For the computerization system, it is going up from $10 million to $20 million. You may say that there is a whole basket of factors, not just inflation. Now, the administrative computer system, this is doubling the amount, and this is really pretty excessive increase. The fundamental issue is that the financial secretary is seeking to adjust the financial ceiling upwards. This is the seventh occasion over the past 20 years or so that we put up the ceiling, and we keep re-harping the old tune. On what basis are we increasing this ceiling? In terms of the magnitude of the increase, you're citing the whole basket of factors, that the ceiling is going to be going up to $50 million. I think there's going to be a significant impact. In reply to us, the government said that we can monitor the government, and the government will be coming up with a table. The government should come up with a breakdown between $30 million and $50 million for projects will be included. And you said that you haven't got specific projects, so you don't have the data for us. I understand that for the time being, but the question is, going forward, maybe next year when we vet the CWRF, are we going to have one-third or double the number of projects? Now, with the increase in the ceiling, maybe some of the projects that marginal will be relaxed, and there may be some individual projects that will be put in under this CWRF that otherwise would be presented individually. So from electrical members' point of view, now we are dealing with a paper which is more than 1,000 pages. Now we will endorse this in two meetings, and you say that there will be no problems. Next year, we're going to have a paper which is 1,800 pages. So the administration and the finance committee and the secretariat would or should come up with a way for us to scrutinize these projects effectively as a result of the increase in the volume of the projects being included.
Second, a more fundamental question about the financial ceilings for Category D projects. We know this has to do with district works or advanced works of such district works. But from examples we have seen, we can tell that some government departments have been breaking down some controversial, albeit livelihood works projects, into smaller portions. Now you're doing the bundling. When you have a ceiling at $50 million as the new ceiling, will there be more situations where land resumption, say in Yunlong South, that are taken forward under the guise of advanced works, so that you get works projects that would have been needed to go to the Finance Committee but end up being able to sneak through after upward adjustment of the financial ceiling? It's about the mechanism. Are you saying you're adjusting the ceiling based on a basket of factors? But if you have a project cost up to $50 million, is that still a Category D project? Secretary, please. I want to thank Dr. Chang's questions. I'll take these points one by one. One thing I want to clarify. Why are we doubling the financial ceiling for the computerization initiative and for the other ceiling, it's $30 to $50 million? Now, the starting points are different for the two different heads. For the computerization head, it was last adjusted in 1996, but for the heads of expenditure 702 to 707-708, that one was last adjusted in 2012. So these are two entirely different matters. And the second point, how can we work with the electrical in such a way as to make sure the electrical can exercise effective oversight over our work? Now, would that mean a surge in the number of capital works or in the terms of the price levels? Under the new arrangement, works projects that would have needed to go to FC would be able to get listed under the Capital Works Reserve Fund projects. If there's a pressing work project, we will get to those projects. But the only difference is that some projects would go under the Capital Works Reserve Fund projects. Others go to the Finance Committee for scrutiny. But there will still be a process of scrutiny, and there's no change to that. And as Dr. Cheng rightfully pointed out just then, how can LegCo play the role of exercising oversight in the days to come? There will be quarterly reports and annual reports on these Capital Works Reserve Fund projects. There will also be internal adjustments on our side. We're exploring something on the side of the Development Bureau. We will look into ways to make sure public funds are well spent. Taking into account a variety of factors, we will do what we can to make sure we can exercise effective control over project costs. Next, Mr. Yu Siwing, 5 minutes. Thank you, Chair. First question about the refurbishment works, 3004 and other works. What do we mean by the refurbishment works? Is it based on the results from inspections, or about how long the facilities have been used, or is it after only other people report or complain about the facilities and then you proceed to refurbish the facilities? Now, for public toilets, if there's no complaint, nothing is done about those projects. But if there is a complaint, then someone takes action. Are there criteria for you to take action and carry out refurbishment works to make sure our cityscape still looks good and the facilities are still serviceable for the public? And second, about a minor investigation, the consultant fees for minor investigation, that is 300 something. I find it puzzling. Now, there's this reference to 36 classroom primary schools. Now, you're paying $60 million for the consultant's fees of the minor investigation works. But for the 12 classroom schools, the special schools, that would be $13 million. And you also have money for the 24 restroom classroom primary schools. For the money to be spent on consultants' fees and minor investigation works, what's the basis for you to determine the estimate? Who's drafting these reports? If there's no objective basis for coming up with the costs, then there is the risk that people just dictate the price levels and the consultants' fees. And then the consultant firms just kind of dictate the fees, and then you end up wasting public funds. And then the next question about the public work, the public toilets. Over the past few years, we know the refurbishment of public toilets has been a matter close to the hearts of many officials. Say the public toilet on Shekho Road, do you go by your usual practice? That is, now that you have more experience with renovating public toilets, and just then you talked about this particular initiative about public toilets. Going forward, would you be taking stock of your experience and have more public initiatives, invite public views on public toilet designs? While you don't necessarily have to go by this particular example, but will you be taking forward public toilet related initiatives in that direction? I agree with these concerns raised by Mr. Ronick Chen and Michael Tin. I get the point about the computerization it hasn't been adjusted for a long time so that's why you need to double the ceiling for the computerization head. But for the beefing up of the financial ceiling from $30 to $50 million, I take issue with the data. You don't have the data to justify your proposal to beef up the ceiling. You need to explain to us more clearly, why do we need the $20 million increase in the financial ceiling? So these are my four questions. Maybe I'll invite my colleague from the Architectural Services Department to take this question, and I will also address the point about the upward adjustment in the financial ceiling. ASD, please. Refurbishment works, 3004GX. The ASD is working on 8,000 old aged buildings, more than 1,000 of them are more than 30 years of age. We are carrying out preventive maintenance on these buildings. We try to identify needs for repairs. This is something our department is taking forward. Say you have dilapidated rooftops, there may be risks of leakage or structural concerns. Under 3004, you see project about sports grounds with high usage. That's why we recommend repair works. And for 3001GX, it has to do with schools. You see different price tags for different investigation works. Now, these prices are assessed by ASD staff. We look at the conditions of each site. There may be slopes at a given site creating more difficulties, or there may be more trees. And at some sites, even though you have a 12 classroom school, but it's a traffic node. So we have to be mindful of the impact of any works on the traffic. So we need to go deeper in compiling the reports. And hence, you see variations in the price tags for different projects. I just stand the public toilet initiative we brought up. We want to get the views of young people, young architects, and staff working at public toilets. We're trying new things with the repair works of public toilets. The public want these works to be done as quickly as possible so that the closure time can be minimized. Now we're going by the DFMA approach, so that we can have different parts of a public toilets pre-manufactured elsewhere so that we can actually just assemble everything on site. And that's how we will be able to shorten the closure time of public toilets when we will be trying out different things. Secretary, please. Thank you, Chair. I want to address this point about increasing the financial ceiling from $30 to $50 million. And that's 67% increase. Last adjustment was 2012. And from 2012 to 2020, the price factor adjustment is around 40%. Now, here's one reason why we want to beef it up to $50 million. We look at future estimates. And based on the supplementary paper, we are looking at the projected inflation in 2030. Now, this price ceiling will remain valid for some years to come. The last adjustment was 2012. So that's why we not only have to look at historical patterns, we also have to be mindful of where things will go in the future. We're proposing a 67% increase in price ceiling. And based on our price adjustment factor, we can expect another 67% increase in price levels by 2024. But if other things change in the economy and may have a bearing on our projection. But there is certainly a quantitative basis in our justification. Our colleague from the Development Bureau could also tell us more about this. But first, I need to invite Dr. Priscilla Leung to speak. Chair. Now, the government needs to be careful with the purse strings. The same goes for many citizens. The taxpayers also, many of them are cash-strapped, many out of a job. That's why we need to be careful with spending every single dollar in the public coffers. Now, I see many different items lumped together in this paper. I need clarification on 3 points to help me better understand how you determine what items to put in your paper. I had 703 about education. The chief executive, secretary for education, and other officials have been making remarks on this point. Now, we are giving $10.8 billion. At first, there was $5 billion for the Education Bureau, but then the Education Bureau kept asking us for extra funding. It usually has to do with infrastructure works. But how do you actually spend the money and split up the money? So I decided to put questions to you for every funding proposal for education purposes. What's your plan? Where does the money go? Now, this time you're coming to us with mine relatively modest sums. I support your proposal, but I hope that going forward, you can show us a plan. What issue are you trying to address with each funding proposal? Of greater concern is that now that we are cautious about the purse strings, and then the government departments try to break down large projects into smaller projects and make it appear that we have already agreed to pass to endorsing your proposals. Just don't do that, because you will be undermining the relationship between the executive and the legislative branch. I will be closely watching your funding proposals about the education sector. Second, computerization. Head 710. The FEHD, the Civil Service Aid, have been coming to us for funding. Here's my concern. Some years ago, we lost voter data, more than 3.6 million data. Is there any update about this on the system in the Electoral Affairs Office? Well, these are matters of concern to us about updating your information technology infrastructure, or take the Food and Health Bureau. It's dealing with the epidemic efforts. You couldn't even get the SMS messages delivered. Are things going wrong? Or is the Bureau outsourcing the things to outside parties? I have never received a straight answer, and every time I got told nothing's wrong. And that's why I'm chasing the government down on these questions. Why are we getting such fundamental, basic tech glitches? We're just talking about SMS notification of test results. Question 709, I'm talking about the service reservoirs. I'm just bringing this up. Bishop Hill, the water tank on Bishop Hill, whether it's minor works or major works, you need to demolish something, or you may need to build a service reservoir. Have you investigated whether there are monuments, antiquities? This time, we got a member of the public going hiking, and this member of the public spotted the water tank. If it weren't because of that, we wouldn't have known. Is there a mechanism to ensure this doesn't happen again? What kind of steps have you gone through in your procedure with your minor works for service reservoirs? These are my questions. Thank you, Chair.
Thanks very much, Madam Leung. I'd like to call upon the water supplies and the RGO and other officials to address the questions. Chairman, thank you. For the Education Bureau, 708, under the allocation, we are getting on with some of the refurbishment projects. For aided schools and direct subsidy schools, and there are annual renovation projects. Chairman, beg your pardon, I don't really want to waste my time. My question is, the government hasn't used up the money. Why did they still have to come for more money? Who's going to address the question, please? I'm not saying that you shouldn't spend the money. We allocated the money. Where has the money gone to? Why do you have to keep coming back for more money? Madam Lau, I think what Ms. Lau is concerned about is education. Indeed, this current term of administration has earmarked a lot of money to education, but every time the funding was for specific purposes. Today, this proposal, it's not about the recurring expenditure. We are talking about the CWRF and the funding cannot be used for any other purposes. We cannot pay for these projects with the unused sum of money from other items. So this is the constraint that we have. Ocio, Mr. Wang, Chairman. Under the CWRF 710, every year we have 880 ongoing projects. Many of them have to do with the upgrading of the IT security, and these are ongoing projects. Under the requirements, all the systems have to be assessed and upgraded every 2 years. Members expressed concerns about the systems in other departments. In terms of IT security, we do have a team that assists the various departments to improve IT security and meet the requirements. We're seeking to increase the ceiling from $10 billion to $20 million, as the Secretary said a moment ago. Last time, it was in October 1996 that devised the ceiling. There were so many years. That was so many years ago. The inflation has increased, and over the years we have rolled out many applicability, the cloud computing, AI, and big data, and so on. The pricing is also different. So in the entire projects, the funding, the costing has increased. So with the member support, we hope that the ceiling for the delegated authority can be increased, so that we can apply IT more in different departments. We do have the monitoring, doesn't matter how much it is. Our department will be assisting our client departments to do the monitoring work. I think Ms. Dr. Leung is concerned about SMS and the effectiveness of the SMS. How can you ensure the quality there? Chairman, I think the member was talking about the incident last time. We tried to understand from the FHB. It was an outsourced contractor that was responsible for that. We have followed up the matter with FHB to make sure that the service will be up to scratch, and improvement has been made there. Mr. Christopher Zhang, 5 minutes, please. Chairman, thank you. I'd like to follow up on the financial ceiling of delegated authority. I support the increase in the financial ceiling myself earlier. Under the CWRF, Cat D, the ceiling was $30 million. It was put in place in 2012. It's been 9 years now since. For the administrative computer system, it is $10 billion. It was put in place in 1996. So it's been 25 years now. Having regard to inflation and the increase in wages and prices and so on, so I think having regard to these whole host of factors, the increase in the financial ceiling is reasonable. And with this increase, the government can deploy the resources in a more flexible manner to take forward the livelihood minor works. And it will ultimately benefit the members of the public. But what I find surprising is that for the new administrative computer system, the ceiling of $10 billion was put in place 25 years ago. And my question for the administration is this: on what basis would you consider revising the financial ceiling? Are you going to be revising every couple of years? Or is it the case that you would review this when you run out of money? And will these have any implications on the projects for this new administrative computer system? The $10 billion ceiling has remained unchanged for 25 years. Is it the case that they were not sufficiently serious about the threshold, or is it the case that they were not as familiar with the computer system at that time? Now, in theory, with an increase to $20 million, this can take us up to 2046. Some members expressed concerns about the supervision. I think that with the increase in the financial ceiling, it doesn't necessarily mean that all the projects will hit the ceiling. Now, will the administration explain in greater detail in order to ease some members' concerns? So when you increase the financial ceiling, how can you play the gatekeeping role in order to guard against any profligacy and to make sure the taxpayers' money will be well spent? Thanks very much, Mr. Zhang. I'd like to invite Audio to address the ceiling regarding the administrative computer system, but I come back with my explanation on the supervision. Mr. Wong, Chairman, the financial ceiling, we have to look at the changes over the years. Now, with regard to the computer system, the departments would adopt a different technology to use on these systems. So the cost permutation is really a bit of a mixed bag. Other than labor, we have to look at the hardware and the software, and maybe they previously used big frame of computers. Now they are converting to smaller systems, and the prices would come down. So previously, the ceiling was considered appropriate, but over the past couple of years, we tend to use some computer platforms. And in terms of technology, in terms of pricing, there are a lot of variations. And for these platforms, they were bundled with the cloud computing system or the AI services that they will be made available on the cloud. And this kind of bundled system, let's take a computer system with a lifespan of 4, 5 to 7 years. The cost incurred for this kind of system would be 50% higher than the conventional computer system. In order to apply more sophisticated system, which will be charged on the basis of usage, we are seeking to make the adjustment now so that we can apply better technology to these computer system. In terms of data, over the past couple of years, we have similar percentages for the small, medium, and large system. Let's say a $4 million worth of computer system. It takes about 30% of the application, $4 million to $8 million, about 30%. But for those between $8 million to $10 million, it's gone up from 30% to 40% or thereabout. So the departments are under pressure to increase the ceiling. If I may, Mr. Chairman, normally for computer projects of less than $10 million, the vetting period can be within a month. But for any computer system or any allocation more than $10 million, From the point they make the proposal to the time the funding is approved, it would take anything between 7 months, 24 months, so it would impinge on the efficiency of the project. Secretary?
Hey.
Chair, I want to address the point, the concern about speakers not using a microphone. Yes. First, we take it very seriously. That is the use of delegated authority. This will not undermine the authority of the Legislative Council in exercising oversight over the government. We have clear internal guidelines. Controlling officers must not break projects down into smaller chunks just to avoid oversight of the LegCo. And the Works Department also have to prepare papers modeled on PWSC papers for scrutiny so that projects can be set up under the relevant subheads. And for each year, in submitting the papers on block allocations, there will be project details to be submitted. There will be details on projects to be taken forward, the expected costs and the project and the cash flow. There will also be regular, that is, quarterly reports made to the Public Works Subcommittee to update members on the works, the cost, etc., about the projects under the CWRF. Now, there will also be any reports submitted on the projects under the Capital Works Reserve Fund about the actual progress of the works. And there will also be information on any variation, major variations between how works are actually carried out on one hand and how we expected the works to play out in the first place. So there, nothing will undermine the LegCo's power in exercising oversight over our work. Next, Mr. Holden Chow. I want to say something about the financial ceiling of designated authority for the Capital Works Reserve Fund projects. The reasoning behind this arrangement is that for the document that runs over 1,300 pages, most of the works are district level works. It's really minor works, road works and other infrastructure works. I get the point behind it. These are relatively minor works. If we can get these projects taken forward and by putting them under the CWRF, and then we just let them do it. That's the reasoning behind it. At the meeting of the PWSC, I put forward a suggestion. I don't see any response from the government about my suggestion. We need to ensure efficiency about the efficiency about the minor works, about district level works. I have no objection about taking forward district level works, but something of public concern is the use of public funds. How do you exercise oversight so that the works actually hit the mark? Well, I haven't been an electrical member for a long time, but for each year, for the paper that runs over 1,000 pages, each works project comes with information on the NU estimate, etc. At the Public Works Subcommittee meeting, I made this point. At the district level, oversight can be exercised. It's not about the cost, it's also about the works progress. The people at the district level, they have a better sense of how works are going. Well, the district councils are dysfunctional at these points. They no longer work. I'm not asking you to take this matter to district councils, because these days, district councilors are not doing their jobs properly. Here's what I want you to do. Can you tell me? I suggested that you should gauge views from other channels, area committees, for example. Can you update area committees on the progress of district level works. These people work at district level. They are in a better position to keep an eye on the progress of district level works. If we endorse your proposal and you start to take forward your works, but for district level works, minor works, what's the progress of these works' progress? I hope that the people doing the district level work can keep an eye on the district level works projects. I hope there is this layer of oversight. Now, we are focusing on your proposal here today. Then we may raise questions about particular projects that are close to our hearts, but we won't be able to get to every single project in your paper that runs to 1,300 pages. But you do need a layer of oversight at a district level, that is, people engaged in district level work, and that will help enhance the effectiveness of your work on district level works, because someone will be able to draw your attention to issues coming up at the district level. But I don't see in this paper or anything from your colleagues about my suggestion. Here's my view. For district level works, can you work more closely with area committees so that they can keep an eye on how district level works projects are going? That would be the more effective way forward. Can the government tell me if they will consider their suggestion? Secretary, please. Mr. Holden Chow gave us a clear direction in his question. In taking forward our projects, how do we take a more targeted approach by gauging the views of people at the district level? We gauge the views from different districts at different levels. I want to first invite my colleague from the Architectural Services Department to tell us more about how they gauge district level views in their course of work, and if where appropriate, I'll call my colleague from the Home Affairs Department will also elaborate. We work with the user departments, that is, the department initiating the proposal. They may report the matter at the district council level, or they may also go to the area committees. At the district level, the Home Affairs Department is also at a better in a better position to tell us a bit more about how things will go in the future. Are you finished or you're not finished? We try to facilitate the proposals from the user department. But I want to see if my colleague from the HAD has anything to add for district councils. Chair, I need a response from the HAD because I'm talking about area committees. HAD, please. We appreciate this point. For district level minor works, we're there to serve the public. We agree that broadening the scope of consultation is the right way to go. We will keep an open mind. Mr. Holden Chow suggested listening to the views from area committees, and they are certainly a key player in the process. We will gauge their views to make sure that our projects actually meet the needs of the people there. Next, Mr. Martin Liao. Chair. I want to say something about HAD 708, the building of welfare facilities at housing estates. Chair, these are livelihood initiatives. We need to make sure the public funds are well spent and that we achieve cost effectiveness. From 20, the estimate was $177 million in 2020-21. And then there's a decrease in funding of $34 million, 15.96% is the percentage decrease. The government told us from 2020-21 explains that by a drop in the cash flow requirements. And based on what I see in the paper, 8001SX, apart from the 100 plus projects, there were also three new items. then how come you have a drop in the cash flow requirement? Are you taking more cost-effective measures? Or is there delay in your project? If there is delay, what's the cause of a delay? And second, we have an aging population. In terms of elderly care and rehabilitation services, there's a shortage of such services. In the 2020 policy address, the government proposed purchasing premises to provide welfare facilities. And there's $20 billion to be set aside to purchase private premises for welfare facilities. In July 2020, the FC granted and or endorsed the proposal. But the Secretary for Labor and Welfare told us they have to take into account the premises available on the market and the price levels out there. The $20 billion may not be able to meet the needs. And they may not be able to provide the most urgent need facilities because there are requirements about the area and other building requirements. It's unlikely that they can get all the facilities they need. In view of this development, will the government consider speeding up the construction of welfare facilities, elderly homes, and housing estates? And in planning of welfare facilities or the purchase of private premises for welfare facilities, how do you make sure that these two things can tie in with one another? Are there plans or indicators for assessing the effectiveness of these initiatives? I will invite my colleague from the Transport and Housing Bureau to talk about the housing aspect. And then my colleague from the Social Welfare Department will elaborate on the provision of social welfare facilities. Who's going to take the lead? Mr. Holman Kitt. For public housing, we go by the Hong Kong Planning Standards and Guidelines as the basis of our work. We negotiate with the relevant departments. As to the point raised by Mr. Martin Liao, the head suggest by the member has to do with something else. But for public housing in general, we follow the Hong Kong Planning Standards and Guidelines as the basis of work. We liaise with the local stakeholders and the relevant bureaus to find out the kind of facilities we need for each project. Thank you, Chair. Then Social Welfare Department, please. Ms. Chu. For 2021 to 2022, the funding we apply for, there will be a drop in by $33 million or so in the funding we apply for. That's really a change in the cash flow requirements. In 2021, we have certain projects, say public housing in Taipo or the Northwest Kowloon Reclamation Projects. These projects are close to completion. That explains the lower cash flow requirements by $60 million in terms of cash flow. But there will be new items to be launched this year or next year. It's all about the cash flow requirements. For new items come with a lower cash flow requirement in the first year. So that's why you see a drop in cash flow requirement. But will there be plans or indicators about the planning of welfare facilities in public housing and the purchase of private premises for welfare facilities? The Social Welfare Department takes a multi-pronged approach to this matter. For public rental housing, we try to work with the relevant departments, housing department or planning department. We try to fit in welfare facilities. That's for long-term work, because planning takes years and so does construction. As for the purchase of private premises for welfare facilities, that's more like a short-term fix. We see an aging population, and there's keen demand on welfare facilities. So we try to get welfare facilities through a variety of ways. We also have other measures, say for land sale. We try to fit in welfare facilities. And there may be government institutional community use sites, and if they're suitable sites, we try to get those sites for welfare facilities. And the same goes for idle school premises. There is keen demand on welfare facilities. That's why we try to identify sites through a variety of ways.
Mr. Chin, this whole 5 minutes, 708, subhead A100EX. That's the UGC seeking $760 million. The first part is the ongoing projects. I'd like to ask about the Poly University 145. The building, the consultancy fee of the teaching school, $16 million will be involved. 18.6 will be involved in Poly U. At BU, the lifts will be upgraded. A, G, G, H, J, and D, E wing. The classrooms will have to be improved. And also the proposed new projects, there are 10 items. Five of them belong to the Poly U. A, wing A, the clinical laboratory will have to be upgraded. Wing A, G, FG, eighth floor, the laboratory will be upgraded. The Block U, fourth floor, they will be upgrading. GH, first floor, the laboratory will have to be upgraded. And item 10, Block W, the seventh floor, it will have to be upgraded. So altogether, there are 8 items here, costing us $250 million. So of $700 million, one-third, we go to the Poly U. 29.9 billion dollars, and you're seeking $6 million. My first question is this. Now, Poly U has to undergo so much renovation on each and every floor. What exactly are they doing? What is the layout there? It seems to me that it is in bits and pieces, but this mounts up to a lot of money. The laboratory will be upgraded. Last year, the year before last, during the Black Hat violent protest, they had to spend $700 million on the renovation, on the repair. Now, what is the relationship between this and that expenditure? I do think they should make up for the insufficient sum with this allocation. Now, if you have to upgrade the entire campus, that's another matter, but then you have to tell us in the entire project, what is the long-term repair and maintenance? I think the governing committee has to come up with the whole picture. We're not the AGM where you can draw as much money as you like. Now, this is close to $250 million, and you are seeking this funding in a non-transparent manner. It's not good enough. I accept the point about inflation and the cost increase and so on, but it seems to me that you are breaking down these projects into smaller sizes. And with these projects, we may see more in the same category next year. For repair and maintenance. How come they cannot use some of the reserves? Now, UGC, Mr. Leung, might wish to address this. If we disperse the funding, does it mean that UGC doesn't have to do any thinking, and you can just pass all the money from the right hand to the left hand? Mr. Leung, a couple of questions here about the first part. For these projects, some of the buildings were damaged during the social events, and the question is whether there is any relationship with this funding. The members can rest assured that for these projects, none of them has to do with the repair and maintenance that will be necessitated because of the social events. There is none. Before the social events, many of the proposals were put in place before the social events. In fact, together with the ASD, we've been conducting site visit to make sure that we're not doing any repair in the context of the social events. Now, the question was why there are so many projects that belong to the PolyU. There are a couple of categories. The first one is the scientific research projects that will necessitate upgrading of the laboratories. The PolyU has been increasing the strength in scientific research over the years. They need to upgrade the industrial center. The plant used to be a little bit outmoded, and they want to resort to AI and mechanization, and they are undergoing some transformation there. There are other scientific research projects like the cell therapy laboratory. This is going to be the first in Hong Kong, and this is a medical grade laboratory in terms of cleanliness. And they can cooperate with a medical organization in the provision of the services. So they are doing a lot of catching up in scientific research. Second, in terms of medical manpower, the government has a long-term plan. In terms of physiotherapists and allied professionals, they are seeking to enhance the provision there. So the long-term vision is to build a block that will be built to cater for the teaching needs. Like Mr. Ho said, the first one is a consultancy study, and some of the buildings will be demolished to build an integrated teaching building. And this falls within the remit of a consultancy study. There are other minor projects where they are doing a lot of catching up to meet the teaching needs and some of the facilities, like the optician, optometrist facilities will have to be upgraded. Mr. Michael Tien, 4 minutes, please. Chairman, thank you. I've got a question for the ASD chief. I asked about whether someone from the government would vet the necessity of certain projects. Now, you said that you will ascertain that, and there will not be any glossing over. You will look at the technical aspect and also the tender and so on. Now, the question is, there are many projects, 703, 3103GX, I asked this last time. This is costing us more than $100 million. A lot of them are renovation works. And there is the solar lamp project. Now the question is, who is responsible for vetting the urgency of these projects? Now let's say the Treasury is awash with cash and you don't know how to give people the cash payout, and then I would drop my question. I want the FS to dish out $8,000 cash and to come up with the consumption coupon in order to stimulate the economic recovery. And all these would come with a price tag. So certain projects that would be needed might be delayed. So other than looking at the projects, would you also ascertain the urgency of the projects? Can they be put off a couple of years? There are certain projects, you said you cannot overrule them, but is it the case that we have to get on with these today, or can we put them off a couple of years? Yes, ASD, please. Thanks very much, Mr. Tin. I can say a little bit more about the flow, workflow. The policy bureaus would, depending on their needs, put forward these projects. When they submit these proposals, we do have the minor works committee. The secretariat will collect the proposals and accord priority. Now, we will look at all these bureau proposals. We would abide by certain principles and then accord the priorities again. Like whether this is tying in with the chief executive's initiative to improve livelihood, like renewable energy, public toilets, and so on. And there are certain projects that tie in with the budget undertakings. They would command a higher priority. There are certain projects that have to do with cleanliness, building security, that we are concerned and we put high priority. Did this committee ever give lower priority to projects that the departments would insist on a higher priority, or would you just go by the priority recommendation of the departments? Now, when these projects come to the committee, which is composed of many bureaus, that the bureau may want a commanding priority, but they have to compete with other proposals. So how does it work? Would there be any secret ballot? We have a secretariat there, and the secretariat would, in accordance with the principles I mentioned, accord priority, like security, like other factors, like the demolition of certain buildings in order to boost the land supply and so on. In the process, the committee would listen to the bureaus. Would there be any secret ballot? How are you going to decide on the priority, or would you go by the priority as recommended by the departments? The departments have a list, and they would go into a bag, and the committee would be scrutinizing these projects in the bag. We have an infrastructure project under the Treasury Bureau. We have an ASD, the GPA, FSTB that are represented on this particular group. Mr. Tin, would you queue up again, or would you get the question out of the way now? Right, turn up the mic for Mr. Tin, please. Very quickly, where every department would insist on the priority, let's say they have 10 items, 100 items, and then you look at all these different proposals, I'm sure that there's going to be a collective decision. So how does this collection take place? Well, this collective decision is on the basis of the committee. Now, for $20 billion projects, we have the smaller scale project committee. For the $30 million, that's the present ceiling, that's the GPA, the infrastructure committee. So how do you actually go about deciding on the priority of the proposals? We will circulate a list to various departments where necessary. We can have face-to-face meetings. Dr. Ching Chung Tai, 4 minutes, please. Chairman, four questions about the way forward. I didn't mean to put this question at FC, but since Mr. Holden Chow raised this, I have to follow up. This is in the right direction. Under the CWRF, there are minor works like the building of a flight of staircase prior to 1999, before the dissolution of the two municipal councils, they could scrutinize the projects. Now, with the dissolution of the municipal councils, the power has been transferred, and we are not sufficiently equipped, well enough equipped to deal with this. And we will not be micromanaging to the extent that we look at the staircases. But after 1997, this is the weird situation we have. Mr. Holden Chow, I thought that he would support empowering the district council or re-establishing the municipal councils. Rather, he is suggesting that we should empower the area committees. And the HAD said, yes. Now, what are the area committees? These people, these area committee members, are appointed by the government. I wouldn't doubt the composition of these members, but effectively, they are appointed by the HAD. So in principle, how can you ask these appointed people to monitor these projects? If anything, the area committees do not have the power. They are responsible for cleanliness, historically. So this is the fundamental system, the ABC of the fundamental system. The district council, you are trying to sideline them, that these are my words, I won't conjecture your motive. But going forward, are you going to be empowering the area committees? Is that what you mean? Of course, I don't think it's appropriate for us to discuss this here at the finance committee. Mr. Chow raised this suggestion, and the government responded accordingly. I find this wholly mind-boggling. You don't have to address my question. I'm just making a comment. I've got a more meaningful question.
First, just then Dr. Priscilla Leung kind of touched on it, but the government didn't give a straight answer. Over the past 4 years, look at the funding for the Category D projects. 2017, 2018, $12.4 billion. 2019 to 20, that's $14.9 billion. 2020-21 to $22.4 billion or so. Now you want to beef up the financial ceiling for delegated authority from $30 to $50 million. Is there a fundamental projection so that with the CWRF, how much money we are looking to set aside for next year? You talked about you look at a basket of factors instead of just inflation for the increase in financial ceiling. There should be a figure you have in mind. It may be $40 or $50 billion under CWRF in the next year. Can you address this question first? Secretary, please. Just then another member brought this question too. It's hard to tell you the specific figure in the days to come because the conditions are always changing. But let's talk about the kind of projects. Port improvement works and the addition of covers for pathways. These two kind of projects, we do expect increases in costs. But we cannot clearly project changes in project costs in the future, but look at historical patterns about the amount of CWRF block allocations. The member has it right that we were talking about a third upward adjustment from $30 to $50 million. Let's look at the number of projects that fall within the scope from historical data from 2017-18, 18-19, 19-20, 20-21. We're talking about single digits in terms of a number of such projects. They represent an insignificant number in the vast number of works projects scrutinized by Electrical every year. I hope that could assuage members' concerns about Electrical's role in exercising oversight of our work. Next, Mr. Yu Siwing. I want to ride on a previous question for the Secretary. The refurbishment works. The Director of Architectural Services told me that you have a team, you do inspections, and then you decide whether you take forward refurbishment or repair works. How many people are there on your inspection teams? You said there were about 9,000 such projects? You said there were 9,000-ish such projects. How many people do you have on that? Do you have enough manpower? There are so many government premises. Do you have enough manpower to inspect all these places? How long does each inspection take? There are many government premises dilapidated. Are you short of manpower, or do you set a low target with your inspection? Do you want to use every premises all the way up to a point it becomes unserviceable? What are the criteria for you to determine whether you take forward repair works? Next, the other question has to do with investigation and consultant fees. You said it depends on the site conditions, slopes, etc. Do you have a vetting procedure? Who gets to decide on the consultant fees and the investigation fees? Does someone draft a report? What level of official will make a decision? Does that official has adequate understanding of the subject matter to determine whether any given cost is a reasonable cost? Who will take this question? ASD? About 3004, that subhead, the buildings department is responsible for the maintenance of more than 8,000 buildings. That's a lot of work. We divide them up into different areas: Hong Kong Island, Kowloon, New Territories. And then we look at things at district level, Tsim Sha Tsui, etc. For each area, we have a professional team. Technical staff assist these teams. I talked about preventive maintenance. For that, we engage consultants to help us inspect buildings. Whenever issues are identified, we make a professional judgment call. Under subhead 3004, we make professional judgments over areas like rooftops. Are there things dilapidated enough to warrant repair? That we make a decision on those questions. It's an ongoing process. For the 8,000 or so buildings that have been around for more years will be accorded higher priority. As for subhead 3001GX, as the member has rightly pointed out, there's a clear mechanism in the government on this. Under 3001GX, when we engage consultants for investigation for schools, for example, there's a cost involved. It may take a chief architect, a chief level professional. Sometimes it takes an assistant director, or the project may come to me for the vetting. So there is a mechanism in place on the officials who will look at the cost. 3004, subhead 3004, the consultant inspects a site and provides the advice. Do you engage in consultant after tendering exercise or some other ways for preventive maintenance work? We have surveying professionals who will assist us. But our staff at the district level, they are familiar with the local situation. When they take note of buildings that require attention, they will let us know. We also work with the user department. We stay in touch, and when there's a need for repair, we will be informed. Dr. Priscilla Leung, 4 minutes. Chair, I want to focus on 708 and 710. For 708, that is head 708, I want a response from the government. When you have a surface reservoir, before the works commence, what procedure would you go through? Doesn't matter what size the works project is, it's more than just funding. There may be unintended damage to structures of heritage value unbeknownst to us. By the time you come to us for the funding, what kind of process do you have to go through? For Shamsui Bishop Hill, the order was to demolish the structure. Was there a procedure to go by? 1904 was the year when the Roman style tank was built. In 1930, it became a surface reservoir, but these factors weren't taken into account when you were building things. Is this still the model you go by in your decision-making in 2021? Second question, to follow up on the response from the government, I need more clarity. Well, you said you had to look at it to make sure. Now, that's the SMS. You said they won't. We won't have a recurrence of the failure for SMS messages to reach the recipient of COVID tests. Are you saying that you won't be using certain private contractors? Will you be using your in-house testing service after a major blunder? And the Election Affairs Commission, will you be outsourcing services? We're talking about voter data. There's data security concerns. Will you be doing everything in-house? I don't see a theme, a common thread in what in your exercise. You should be telling us where you're up to, how you're coming along with your work. We work with the FEHD a lot. They always come back to us for funding. So here's my hope for the Food and Health Bureau, the FEHD, and the Electoral Affairs Commission. What do we stand in terms of your tech? Let's start with the Water Supplies Department. WSD, please. About the tank of Bishop Hill. When we take forward works projects, we have to consult the Antiquities and Monuments Office to assess whether there's any impact on structures of archaeological or historic interest. The AMO explained this matter. Could you speak into the microphone, please? The AMO offered an explanation about the incident about Bishop Hill. The Development Bureau has set up a working group to look into the incident and the relevant procedure to see if there's further room for improvement or measures to be taken. There is work ongoing. As for the WSD, the priority is to strengthen and consolidate the water supply facility at Bishop Hill for heritage assessment in the future. After the strengthening works are completed and assuming it's safe to do so, we will explore whether it's feasible for the public to visit the structure. I'm talking about the other surface reservoirs. Will you have a procedure in place to so that the same kind of thing won't happen again? Going forward for waterworks projects or infrastructure works in general. We will be more cautious in terms of a consultation with AMO. We will have this working group reviewing the relevant procedure to identify areas for further improvement. Who's going to elaborate on the information technology side of things? About the Electoral Affairs Commission, that is the loss of voter data, leakage of voter data some years ago. The department has reviewed the matter, and they looked at the procedure for handling personal data. And for upcoming elections, Our department will also be part of the process by offering expert advice and for implementing the project, we will be supporting the effort of the EAC. Hopefully, we can instill confidence among members in this regard. And as for the Food and Health Bureau, the failure of the FHB to deliver, to send over SMS messages to inform the test results, send over test results. Now, we have requested that private contractors exercise greater caution in dealing with SMS messages. Now, we do have in-house systems for sending over test results. Hopefully, we can improve the reliability and accuracy of our services. Our office is also working with the FHB on test results and data in general. We'll step up support, that is the tech support, to maintain the quality of our service.
Dr. Leung, Chairman, I hope that they will respond in writing how they're going to deal with these contractors who have fallen down on their jobs, in particular those that have caused so many problems, like the REO and the FHB contractors. Will there be any penalty instead of just instructing them to do a better job? I'm not sure about how your outsourcing work. Chairman, I will convey Dr. Leung's requests to the two bodies for a response. Let's take a break for 10 minutes.
What did I say?
We'll resume at 4:41.